And good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Yellow Jacket Coaches Show with Head Coach Steve Berdow on WFJA Sports. I'm John Hockaday, filling in for Keith Womack, and tonight we will talk about the Yellow Jackets game this past Friday night at Richmond County, as well as our upcoming game this week against Scotland. Our Coaches Show this season is once again brought to you by a great group of our local businesses, and we want to take this time to thank Wilkinson Cadillac Chevrolet Buick GMC, Domino's, Sheriff Brian Estes, Fix-It Plumbing, Pies Pizza, and Knott's Funeral Home. We're going to take a short break and hear from a few of our Coaches Show sponsors, and we'll be back with Head Coach Steve Berdow to talk Yellow Jacket football right after these messages. And we do welcome you back to the Yellow Jacket Coaches Show with Head Coach Steve Berdow. I'm John Hockaday, and we're ready to talk some Yellow Jacket football. Lee County lost on the road to Richmond County this past Friday night, a score of 34-13. Lee County fell behind 13-0. It was 13-7 midway through the third quarter, with the Raiders eventually pulling away there for the win. Coach, it was a game where we saw a really bad field position. I think the first half of the play, really hard to run the ball in the first half, but defensively, I thought that we still played good. Your thoughts about Friday's game?
Yeah, I definitely felt in the first half, defense kept us in that game, created a turnover, set us up in a couple decent situations. We didn't do a good enough job on offense in the first half to take advantage of some of those situations. And when offense kind of figured it out a little bit better in the second half, I feel like the defense didn't have enough juice to kind of be able to finish it off.
Well, you know, Richmond came out so aggressive, I thought, really against the run early on, and made it tough for Lee County to run the ball. What changes or what adjustments did you make? Because we did, I think, end up with a little over 70 yards rushing in the second half.
Yeah, one thing was using the technology we have on the sideline to be able to show the plays and remind the guys they actually weren't doing anything that we hadn't showed them on film. They had two main defensive fronts they would run. And we were missing a couple blocks in the first few series, and once we finally got them to do it correctly, it worked out a little bit better.
Well, and of course, Coach, the first game without one of the leading rushers in the state of North Carolina with B.J. Brown, and of course the guy stepped up and did a good job, but it was tough for Lee County to move the ball, and I think we started throwing the ball a little bit more during the game. Was that more because of just what they were giving us?
Yeah, the way they were playing inside the box, they were definitely key on the run, and they were giving us some one-on-one matchups. And with our receivers, we like one-on-one matchups with our receivers.
Well, you know, early in the season, I was looking at some numbers. We were just about 2-1 rush to pass, and Friday night it was close to 50%. And, of course, Keith and I were talking about some of that on the way back. With the change in personnel by injuries, are we going to see it a little bit more closer to 50% throughout the rest of the season?
Yeah, I think that's a possibility, depending on how the other team aligns to us. We're definitely always going to run the football if the run game in the box is light. I feel like we have an offensive line when they're doing what they're supposed to do that can handle a six-man box. When people start adding that seventh guy, we have to be able to throw the ball.
Defensively, the Yellow Jackets, I mentioned, I guess 13 points through the middle of the third quarter. I think Richmond started two drives at the 15-yard line and one at the Jacket 44-yard line, but three of the six possessions in that first half were on our side of the field. And again, only 13 points and all that.
Yeah, defensively, like I said, especially early, I felt like they did a really good job of bowing their backs in some situations. The one score was from like the 12-yard line, 15-yard line, and that after a bad field position on the kicking game, we didn't do a good enough job setting ourselves up in better situations, whether it be offense or special teams, to kind of flip that field. We allowed them to kind of control that part in the first half and kept us, a little bit grounded on our half of the field.
Let's take a look at some of the numbers from the game. And we talked about the Lee County rushing game. Isaiah Peoples stepped in, 9 carries for 37 yards. And I love watching him run. And he really ran hard, had a couple of nice runs in the second half.
He did. He definitely did. I feel like the second half run game, if we could have had that going a little bit better in the first half, it's probably a little bit different football game. I think the amount of plays we ran on both sides of the ball were similar. The amount of time possession was similar. The yards was similar. It was just they didn't have to get as many yards because they had that field position.
And, of course, a couple of other guys, some of the younger guys, Terrence McKendall, 9 yards, scored 2 touchdowns. A lot of short yardage situations for him. B.J. Baldwin came in, I think, gave you some good carries as well. Huge game for him on Thursday night. Yeah, we'll talk about that later, but good to see those guys coming in and chipping in.
Both of those guys we have a lot of confidence in, can come in there with Isaiah and handle the duties and do pretty much anything we need them to do.
And, of course, just taking a quick look at the receivers, 5 different Yellow Jackets caught passes. Ronnie Hooker, I think his first catch of the year, and a nice run after the catch as well.
Yeah, it was impressive after the catch. I think we've had that in the bag, I guess, if we needed it for a little while, and it was good to see that play work out. It was a big key situation on a 4th down. That led to one of our touchdown drives.
Yep, and of course, big nights from Raymond Knotts. 2nd week in a row for him, 5 catches, 76 yards. Jaden Hill with 9 catches as well. Cedric Lett with a catch. Coach, I wish I could see the video of it, but I believe he got wrestled or souffled or something out there after his catch Friday night.
Yeah, it was.
What a tackle.
Got them a 15-yard penalty on it, so he got the 10-yard catch and added 15 yards to it. But I thought our receivers, I told them, yesterday when we were watching film, I thought they played their best game so far. I think Ray and Jaden have definitely continued to grow as the season goes on with Jack. Both of them are ultra-talented dudes. Said it's really his first week of getting significant role on offense. He's played a lot more defense and special teams for us this year. We had a need, and he's another very athletic guy. And Sam's Mr. Reliable. He's going to do everything he's supposed to do. And when the ball came his way, he had him a catch too.
Well, Coach, the only numbers that you really want to win are on the scoreboard. But, when you look at the numbers, really a very even ball game. First downs were 17-15. The total yardage was only 22 yards separating the teams. The 2 big numbers there, when I look at it, the penalties and the turnovers, really proved to be the difference Friday night.
Yeah, definitely. So, and some of the turnovers kind of gave them better field position. One especially led to a touchdown. Another one late. So, I feel like 2 of the turnovers were big keys for them to keep that going. And the penalty yards was something that we did not help ourselves out with several times. So, better decisions on the sideline, smarter decisions sometimes, and maybe a few first downs happened for us and a few less for them.
And one other number I just want to mention, Jack Martin ended up 17 of 24, 201 yards. And, Coach, if I'm not mistaken, he was having 0 time the first 2 possessions. He started out like 1 of 5 and then finished at 17 of 24. Really nice night.
Yeah, he definitely got going after the first 2 series, refocusing and making sure they did what we thought they were going to do. They did what we game planned for. And after those first 2 series, I feel like he was locked in. And the receivers were doing a good job of going up and getting the ball in the key situations.
Well, this has been a tough stretch for Lee County, and playing some very good football teams. We've got another one coming up this Friday night. How is the confidence of this team right now?
I felt like the last 2 days of practice were good days of practice. I think this group is one that is willing to go in there and listen to things that didn't happen well on film and not take it personal. They do try to get better. Coach different teams and seen different kids where they can't handle somebody telling them that, hey, this was an error right here, but if you make this play, this whole series might change. Or if you 3 guys on these next 3 plays do your job, they are taking the feedback. And then they come and grinded it out at practice the last 2 days.
Well, and it's neat to know, and it's neat to see, but it can take just 1 block.
Oh, yeah.
1 block, and it can change a game. And I know that it's important for these guys to understand that. Let's talk a little bit about the JVs. I know we try to do that each week before we go to our mid-show break. And what a game they had.
Yeah, it was a great game on Thursday night. I feel like every it's noticeable Thursday to Thursday, the growth in that young group. It is a lot of freshmen. We ran the ball very well on Thursday, threw the ball in key situations. We've played really good defense throughout the whole season on JV. And it's just good to see the growth from week to week. I feel like if we played ourselves, I said a few weeks we were 2 touchdowns better. We might be 4 touchdowns better than we were in August as a JV team.
Well, and the thing is, I was there. I watched all the first half of it. And this was against Richmond County's JVs, of course. And, well, I think, 17-0?
Yes, sir.
At the half. And it may have been the cleanest half of football I've seen this year, JV or varsity. They really played well.
Definitely so. And it's good to see them grind the game out as well. We've been in every single game on JV. A few games we were up and we got beat late, so it was good to see them finally finish and play 4 quarters.
And I think just worth mentioning, a field goal during that game that probably would have been good from about 45 yards.
Yeah, Alex has crushed them in the last 2 weeks. We had him set up on Friday. We couldn't seem to not want to false start so he could kick one of the Friday night game too.
Yeah. All right, well, great job by the JVs. Congratulations. And, of course, they'll be on the road at Scotland County this week. We're going to take a short break and hear from a few of our sponsors. We'll be back to talk more Yellow Jacket football right after this. And we do welcome you back to the Yellow Jacket Coaches Show with Head Coach Steve Berdow. I'm John Hockaday, filling in for Keith Womack. And, Coach, it's that time of the show where we like to recognize some of the outstanding performances from the week before. And there were a lot of them. I thought a lot of kids really played good football this past Friday night, played hard. But there's always that one that we've got to pick out. And offensively, we went back and forth with several players, and we ended up Jaden Hill as our Norman Financial Group Offensive Player of the Game. 9 catches this past week.
Yeah, 9 catches and a couple big ones that were key first downs. Jaden did a really good job when the ball wasn't coming to him, he still did a really good job of doing his job. That is a growth point for him throughout the season. I believe he is leading the conference in receptions and receiving yards. So it was good to see another big game for him.
Well, you know, and Jaden, it's been fun to watch the growth in him. You know, Coach, the catch that he made over by the Richmond sideline, I guess late in that game, that was a college catch.
Yeah, that was a big-time catch. Kid was in good coverage. We like to say, you know, it's a 50-50 ball is what everybody says when that ball, you know, if it's me or you. I like for us to think that when the ball is in the air to one of our guys, we've gotten it to about 80-20. Our guys are going to go up and get that thing. We work on that so much in practice.
Well, and it seems like the first time in a while that we've had receivers that can go get 50-50
Definitely.
Balls just with their height and with Jaden and Knotts. It's nice to have that size.
Definitely so. And it's really good just to see the growth. Realistically, over the last month, seeing how hard they're working in practice and it's translating into the games. So hopefully that can continue, and that will continue to grow as Jack grows.
Well, congratulations to Jaden Hill, our Norman Financial Group Offensive Player of the Game. And, Coach, defensively, there was such a big group of guys that played well, and it's hard sometimes for us to pull out a pile of 10 guys who was in there making a tackle. So we rely a lot on those names that are called from the PA. We heard Trey Chubb's name an awful lot in that first half defensively for Lee County.
Yeah, I think Trey's a guy that works really hard, does everything he can and supposed to do, tries as hard as he can, works as hard as he can. He's going to play some offensive line as well, plays on a couple of special teams, kind of gritty. He has, in our defense sometimes, the dirty job where – even if he doesn't make a tackle, he's setting up the tackle for, you know, Io or Isaiah or one of the McKendall brothers. So, you know, Trey's a guy that makes a lot happen.
Well, and a lot of guys played well defensively. I actually had a coach from one of the other teams that we've already played tell me that he thought one of our defensive ends, he said number 23, was as good as any defensive player in the conference.
Yeah.
And a lot of these guys have really gelled this year.
Definitely so. Both those guys off the edges have – I feel like as a defense have grown, you know, a lot of juniors in those situations that have played football. But this is the first time they're getting in the varsity football, the meat of the schedule, and they're having to grow through it.
Julian Best, I think he's returned two fumbles this year. I thought we had another one going Friday night.
He needed another half a step. If he got clean running, I don't know if anybody's catching him. That boy can run.
Well, congratulations to Trey Chubbs, our defensive player of the game for the Norman Financial Group. And, of course, our coach's pick, Jack Martin, the Lee County quarterback, as we mentioned, 17 of 24, 201 yards. And I thought he played really well. And you know what? With his feet, he helped Lee County.
So, several first downs with the running game, making the throws, and the throws that he had to make for Jaden and Ray and Sed and Sam to catch those things were all one-on-one coverage where if the ball isn't great, then we have no chance to catch it. Him not having much time because they're bringing six guys on just about every single play, getting hit, whether it's a run or a pass game. The last several weeks, it's been every week this season, but especially these last several weeks, Jack's game has gotten better, better, and better. He's taken an even bigger grasp of the offense, which has allowed us to do more and more. So it's awesome to see. And anything that goes well, he's celebrating with the guys. Anything that goes bad, he takes it so personal that we have to continue to remind him that, you know, it's everybody's job. It's just not you. So he really truly wants to be as good as he can.
You know, just in watching Jack from the start of the season to now, it seems like the game slowed down a little for him.
It does, and it's noticeable in practice. You know, we play against those same defensive ends that the team's got to block, and, you know, there's not a whole lot of time sometimes in practice when Ronnie or Julian or any of the guys are coming off the edges. I think that growth has been very noticeable.
Other games around the conference this past week, Pinecrest 27, Scotland 17 in a battle of unbeatens, Hope County 28, Union Pines 21. And, Coach, this week coming up, and, of course, Lee County will be hosting Scotland County, Union Pines hosting Southern Lee. Hope County will be at Pinecrest. And I guess we need to mention some news about where we're going to be playing on Friday night.
Yes, sir. So we're going to play this Friday night's game is going to be a home game for us, but we're going to play it at Southern Lee due to some concerns with the stadium at the high school.
Well, and that was something I heard a rumor of it on Saturday that they would be looking at it today and making a decision. And of course, it's one based on the press release that we got from the Lee County Schools, one that's being done in safety,
definitely
for safety
so.
Reasons, and safety for the fans and guys like us up on the top of that press box. And so anyway, it's a decision that's been made, and the game will be at Southern Lee this coming Friday night. So also, we want to take a quick look at the conference standings. Right now, Pinecrest on top at 4-0, Scotland County at 3-1, Richmond County at 4-1, Lee County, Southern Lee, and Union Pines all at 1-3, and of course Hope County at 1-4. And Coach, just to sort of lay it out for our listeners, certainly one guaranteed 3A spot, we think, and there usually is a second. Right now, three teams tied at 1-3. In conference play, some really big games coming up.
Yeah, definitely. So these last two games of the season will be key for playoff type chances. You know, people have asked me that question, and to be honest, the only thing that I can look at is we're playing this Friday against Scotland, and we have to be ready to play them. If we don't handle our business versus them, then we have to hope for help from somebody else.
Well, and you know, when you lay it all out and you lay the games out and you go through of all the different combinations, Lee County can conceivably be anywhere from the number one 3A seed all the way to not being in the playoffs.
Yes, sir.
I mean, there's a wide range that's left, and so the results of these next 2 weeks are huge, and I'm sure the kids are certainly aware of that.
Definitely so. And one thing that I tell the kids, I've said it probably on here a few times, is it's less about who we play and it's how we play, and I think that's going to be the same thing this coming up week. I think our conference this year, and Pinecrest has made those plays, but our conference this year is a handful of plays one way or the other for any single game. And I think especially the games we've been in, the games I've seen on film against those the last few teams we've played, three or four plays go one way or the other, and you have different football games. Pinecrest has been making those plays. up until last week against Pinecrest, Scotland was making those plays. So it's about time for us to make some of them.
That's exactly right. Well, let's talk a little bit about our opponent this coming week, Scotland County. You and I were talking a little bit at the break, but it's a team that's very run-oriented and has a very, very good running back.
Definitely. So the running back has around 1,500 yards. They have a real big offensive line. Three guys that are probably Shrine Bowl, East-West type, all-star type guys that one's an underclassman, but there's three really, really, really good linemen and two of them that are maybe just really good instead of really, really good. So one of the better offensive lines we've seen. And Coach Bailey, their coach, is one of the best in the state. He's won some of the biggest games. So it'll definitely be a good challenge.
Well, you know, looking at Scotland County and all the results this year, Coach, they've given up some points defensively. What do you see from them defensively? How can we exploit Scotland County?
Yeah, so they're an aggressive team on defense, and sometimes I feel like that aggressiveness has gotten them where if they one guy misses a tackle or one guy misses a gap, then they've let up a big play here and there. So big play opportunities, hopefully, if we're doing our job. I think some similar opportunities of last week, if they're going to be aggressive on the outside, some of our receivers will have opportunities for big games. Everything, to me, in high school football starts with the offense and defensive line. It's going to be, can our offensive line handle their defensive line? And if so, a lot of good things can happen.
You know, I had the chance to listen to the Mac Brown show a little bit last night, and he kept harping on, you know, our opponent is our opponent, but we're working on us.
Yes, sir.
What are you working on with Lee County this week to make sure we do well to beat Scotland?
Yeah, I think one of the biggest things for us, even defensively is we're in the right position to make the play. Now we have to be able to finish and get the guy on the ground. Offensively, it's being consistent. Sometimes we run really good routes, and the next time it's a yard shorter, which changes a lot. Sometimes we might supposed to block out as an offensive lineman, and we get in the wrong fit, and now that guy has the gap that we need to run the ball in and ball security.
Well, Coach, thank you for coming in and talking about the games past week and this upcoming week. And certainly we'll be there on Friday night pulling on the Yellow Jackets and love to see us get a big win over Scotland County.
Yes, sir. Looking forward to that. And you know, it'll be a little bit different for us. At least it would be in a home-away game, but at least it's right around the street. And I'm sure we'll still have a nice big crowd.
You know, and Coach, I remember 2 years ago we beat this Scotland County team. And if I'm not mistaken, an interception returned by Tyreek McKendall.
Yes, sir.
So maybe one of his brothers will step up and make a play this Friday night.
It'll be fine if any of those guys want to make that big-time play. It'll be fine. We've had two good battles with them the last 2 years on both JV and varsity. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking Thursday and Friday night this week, hopefully be some of the same.
All righty. Well, we're going to take a short break, and we'll be back to close this out. You've been listening to the Yellow Jacket Coaches Show with Head Coach Steve Berdeau. We'll be right back. And we do welcome you back to WFJA Sports. Do want to take just a minute to congratulate Wilkinson Cadillac, Chevrolet Buick GMC for celebrating their 70th anniversary here in Sanford. What a wonderful business they have been to our local community for such a long time. We congratulate them, and we're awfully glad that Wilkinson is here in Sanford. Our coaches show each week has been brought to you by a great group of advertisers. We do thank all of them, and we hope that you will thank them as well, and even thank them with your business. Bringing you the coaches show for 2023, Wilkinson Cadillac Chevrolet Buick GMC, Domino's, Sheriff Brian Estes, Fix It Plumbing, Pies Pizza, and Notch Funeral Home. We want to thank all of you for listening to tonight's show, and good luck to the Yellow Jackets as they host Scotland County. Go Jackets!